Thank you. I'm pleased to be your moderator for this afternoon's session, Finding Cancer Early, What Does It Buy and Cost Us? This is part one, screening. Dr. H. Gilbert Welch is a general internist and a senior researcher at the Center for Surgery and Public Health at Brigham and Women's Hospital in Boston. His work questions the assumption that more medical care is always better. Much of his work, as you will hear, has focused on overdiagnosis and cancer screening, in particular, screening for melanoma, thyroid, lung, breast, and prostate cancer. I will now turn it over to Dr. Welch.
Thank you very much, Michelle, and welcome everybody. This is a first for me, first time I have presented at a national meeting from my living room. I'm not even wearing shoes. I am wearing pants, but you know, this is a whole new world. I'm coming to you from my home in Thetford, Vermont. And of course, we all have to be a little bit more flexible and adapt to the changing circumstances. And the hardest part for me is I cannot see you, nor can I hear you. I'm performing in an empty living room. So we all gotta be a little flexible. I'm gonna try something here. I'm gonna share my screen and hopefully, you will be able to see it, and I will tell you my game plan. I have divided my talk into four sections, and in between, at the end of each, I will pause for questions, because I'd like to hear from you. But I want to hear from you so much, I'd like you to take out your smartphone and open a web browser and go to this web address. It's pollev.com/HGWMD. That's my initials, Henry Gilbert Welch, MD. So again, it's pollev.com/HGWMD. So my first question, which I can see some of you have already jumped the gun, is fine, is to choose the statement that best reflects your experience of the past few weeks. One, fairly typical. Two, challenging, but I have faced similar challenges. Or three, never experienced anything like this before. I'd like all of you to try to answer this, in part because I'm going to continue to ask you some questions throughout the talk, just so I have some sense of where you are on various topics. So I appreciate your participation. Oh, that's great. I'm glad I got a few of you right now. We'll you'll have obviously more chances. Let's take a look at the responses. Oh, some of you may notice you can change. You can continue to add things. So that's why the graphic will move on us. But I'm interested that many of you have faced some similar challenges, but most of you have never experienced anything like this before. Not surprising. I doubt we have anyone in the audience that went through the Great Depression. I hope we're not headed there, but this is a huge economic disruption. We've had a remarkable increase in unemployment, and it's really affected those, unlike myself, who cannot work from home. And I doubt anyone's old enough to have experienced the previous pandemic of 1918, a flu pandemic that, of course, went around the world, took many of lives and many young lives. 100 years later, it looks a little different, but this is right around my home here in Vermont. This is how high school graduation now looks. There's no graduation. Instead, there are pictures outside of students' houses. It's a really trying time. So I want to just start by talking about the impact of COVID-19 on medical care. While some hospitals have been overwhelmed, more have suffered from the opposite problem. They have been emptied. elective surgery was canceled to provide a surge capacity. And what may be in particular interest to this audience is women with early stage breast cancer had their surgeries delayed, and in my institution and others, were instead started on hormonal therapy. Who knows? Maybe we'll learn something. Maybe we will learn that some don't need surgery. Emergency rooms and doctor's offices experienced marked declines in patient volumes all across the country in the last 2 to 3 months. And some of you may have seen this from STAT: routine cancer screenings have plummeted during the pandemic, medical records data shows. And I want to just share that data with you. And what you're looking at is a graph at the number of mammographies in the Epic database. The light colors are previous years. And as you can see, it runs around 9,000 mammograms a week in these data. And it always peaks in October, Breast Cancer Awareness Month. But what happened this year? Well, we started off right around 9,000, then it precipitously dropped. It's not just mammography, it's not just screening mammography. Same is true for colorectal cancer screening and for cervical cancer screening. The reality is the COVID-19 pandemic has effectively stopped cancer screening in the United States. Now, I want to make just a couple of assertions and value judgments. One, COVID has produced huge financial strains, both for governments and individuals. I don't think there's much doubt about that. Two, this warrants a reassessment of the value of various population-wide screening efforts. We want the medical care system to take care of sick people while making sure it does not divert resources away from more important determinants of health, things like income, housing, and education. And if any of you have the opportunity to see Governor Cuomo's talk 2 days ago, his news conference, he was really very eloquent on this topic. So before we talk about breast cancer, though, let's talk about me.
I want to talk about me.
Okay, I want to talk about me. Well, as you might guess, I'm a former country music DJ. This is 1979, KTHE Radio, the country music station in the Bighorn Basin from Thermopolis, Wyoming. Some of you may see some of the old technology in there, might even recognize a disc and what looks like an 8-track cart. And, you know, it was a while ago. But I don't really want to talk about all the diversions along my way of coming to where I am now. I want to tell you a little bit about my work relevant to breast cancer. And in 1993, I did an article with a new radiologist who had come to Dartmouth at about the same time I had, by a guy by the name of Bill Black, a close friend of mine. It's a long title, and it could be said much more simply, of course. Advances in diagnostic imaging was all about the changes in how we could all of a sudden see more, and we were looking at more images. We were looking harder. And that led to overestimations of disease prevalence. Well, that's a fancy way of saying we find more. Whenever we look harder, we find more. Easy idea to get. But it also leads to overestimations of the benefits of therapy, which simply would mean the typical patient appears to do better. Whenever we look harder, we find more disease. That makes sense. But what may be a little bit surprising is now the average patient appears to do better because we found milder forms of disease. And in this article, we considered three cancers. We considered thyroid cancer, prostate cancer, and of course, breast cancer. A few years later, in the middle of the dramatic rise in ductal carcinoma in situ, Bill and I looked at autopsy series to try to estimate the disease reservoir for DCIS, asking the question, how much more breast cancer could we find? Working with my colleague, Elliot Fisher, I did investigations of what happened following screening mammography, how much testing happened after the first mammogram. And in 2006, I was looking at a long-term follow-up of a major randomized trial of breast cancer screening, asking the question of how many extra breast cancers were found, and concluding that one in four cancers detected by mammography are pseudocancers, literally false cancers. That's an old term. Now we would say one in four cancers are overdiagnosed. In 2008, working with a group in Norway, we examined the natural history of invasive breast cancers detected by screening mammography and concluded that some of them may even regress, a topic I want to come back to at the end of the talk. The first time I can find using the term overdiagnosis, it is not my term, was in the BMJ when I was asked to do an editorial. And I entitled it Overdiagnosis in Mammography Screening. The question is no longer whether, but how often it occurs. And in 2010, Bill and I came back and sort of reviewed what we had learned about overdiagnosis in cancer. And the same year, I wrote an editorial for the New England Journal called Screening Mammography, A Long Run for a Short Slide. Now, the bottom line is I've been studying breast cancer screening for a long time. But as Michelle pointed out, I don't really care any more about breast cancer than I care about prostate cancer, thyroid cancer, kidney cancer, and melanoma. All these cancers have substantial overdiagnosis occurring in this country. I'm also concerned about lung cancer. We don't have much lung cancer overdiagnosis in this country now, but other countries do, particularly Taiwan, a problem I'm working on as we speak. I have a number of books on the topic, Should I Be Tested for Cancer? Maybe Not, and Here's Why is my first book in 2004. 2011, with my colleagues Lisa Schwartz and Steve Woloshin, I wrote a book called Overdiagnosed, Making People Sick in the Pursuit of Health. And my most recent book is from 2015 called Less Medicine, More Health, Seven Assumptions That Drive Too Much Medical Care. And if all this is beginning to sound like an advertisement or an effort to sell books, I want to point out that I have no financial interest in any of the books. I made that decision with my first book. All the proceeds, such as they are, and royalties go to local charities in Vermont and New Hampshire. This isn't because I'm a good guy. This is because I was very sensitive not to want to be judged, to be the reason I'm raising hard questions and things that make people uncomfortable wasn't simply an effort to sell books. Oh, there was an article in the New Scientist on me a few, I guess about a year and a half ago, 2 years maybe now. It is not my title. It was called Treated to Death, The Doctor Finding the Overdiagnosis Epidemic. And of course, I didn't really see the article until it was published and was a little bit surprised by this comment. Welch has had an enormous negative impact on the practice of medicine, says Daniel Copans, a professor of radiology at Harvard University. Now, of course, this is actually a professor of mammography at Harvard University. Suffice it to say, some people find the things I'm saying to be quite outlandish. Oh, and by the way, this is the picture that they ran in the article. This is literally about 1,000 yards from me. It's a little cabin in the woods that has no power, no water, but it does have a good wood stove, which is important in the winter, where I do a lot of my work. I showed this picture to some of my mid-career students about a year ago, and one of them pointed out, I see the problem. You are the Unabomber. I don't know if that's right, but anyway. Let's talk about breast cancer. And where I want to start with breast cancer is with the good news and show you breast cancer mortality, the death rate from breast cancer. And as you can see, breast cancer mortality was pretty stable through the 1990. And then it's come down steadily. It's a substantial drop. It's more than a third. The death rate from breast cancer has fallen by more than a third since 1990. That is unambiguous good news. We should celebrate that. Now, here's an interesting observation. This decline is observed in both women of screening age, that is age 40 plus, and in younger women who are rarely exposed to screening, less than age 40. And that brings me to my second question for you. The decline in both age groups suggests that the good news is primarily due to 1, screening, 2, treatment. All right, let's see what people say. All right, most of you make the conclusion that this provides evidence that most of the decline is about treatment. And that is absolutely correct. I don't know of a more simple picture to provide evidence that this is largely about treatment. This is the decline in breast cancer mortality for women age 40 plus. We're starting with it being normalized to the number ones, so everyone is, it's all relative to where it was in 1975 to 1985. This is a decline of about 37%, which almost matches the overall decline because, of course, most deaths from breast cancer are in this age group. But women under age 40 can die from breast cancer too. What's happened to their mortality rate relative to 1975 through 85? Well, it actually started to go down a little earlier and has gone down a little farther. It's down almost by half. I don't know of a simpler picture and more obvious evidence to show this must be largely about treatment. Of course, there's many other pieces of evidence I could share with you, but this is one of the simplest. The good news in breast cancer is largely about improved treatment, not screening. Let me pause and see if there are any questions.
We have a question here. And it is, for those of us with a premenopausal breast cancer diagnosis, no BRCA or genetic markers, should our adult daughters with dense breasts be screened every 6 months with mammography and 6 months later with MRI from age 40 on?
I would say no, and I will tell you more about that when we get to number 4. Which is looking harder for small cancers, MRI screening. So I appreciate the question, and we're going to be talking more about that.
Okay, I think you can go on, and we have other questions we can have later.
All right, sounds good. All right, I'd like to learn a little bit more about you. Where are you now? Are you in a U.S. state on the East Coast? Are you on a U.S. state in the West Coast? Are you somewhere in between in the heartland? Or are you from Wyoming? Well, let's see where everyone's from. Oh, we got a lot of East Coast people. So we got some changes, but I don't see anyone from Thermopolis or Casper. Okay, well, good. So I have some sense the West Coast may still be asleep. Who knows? It's not that early, is it? All right. So this is a mammogram. It's a mammogram that is from a 54-year-old woman who's already had a lumpectomy for breast cancer, who presents with a palpable triple negative cancer. There it is. It's a large palpable, and that means it's able to be felt. Triple negative means this is biologically unfavorable cancer. This was 5 months after a normal mammogram. This is a so-called interval cancer. It's occurring in the interval between two mammograms. It's a fast-growing cancer, right? It's not there 5 months earlier, and then it's obvious 5 months later. Now I want to show you a different set of mammograms. And this is a 76-year-old woman with a mammographically detected 0.9 centimeter cancer. ER positive, PR positive, HER2 negative. So it has both the estrogen and progesterone receptor and does not have HER2. This is a screen detected cancer, and it's a biologically favorable cancer. And as you can see, I want to thank Dr. Lannan, a breast cancer surgeon at Yale, who shared these slides with me. And what Dr. Lannan did is he wanted to go back and look at old mammograms and see whether he could see this lesion. And here it is a year earlier, and there's the lesion. And here it is 2 years earlier. And can you see the lesion? Sure, it's there. And this is now 3 years earlier. Is the lesion there? Yes, it is. And 4 years earlier, it's still there. That's a slow-growing cancer. And that's my point. There's a lot of heterogeneity. There's a lot. This is a very slowly growing cancer. So we need a way to think about the heterogeneity, the variability of cancer progression. And I do that with a very simple chart. On the y-axis, I'm going to put the size of the cancer. I'll say it starts as an abnormal cell. I know it starts earlier than that with a genetic hit, but this is good enough for our purposes. It gets big enough to ultimately cause symptoms. In this case, it's something that's palpable. Someone can feel it. It gets large enough to be at a size that causes death. Now, I need to complete this framework with another dimension, and that other dimension is time. And time is bounded by the point at which a person dies from something else. And with this framework, we can kind of consider the heterogeneity of cancer progression. That's a fast-growing cancer. It starts as an abnormal cell, quickly goes on to cause symptoms, and quickly goes on to cause death. This is a slowly growing cancer. It is growing, it will cause symptoms, it will become palpable, and it will cause death. Now, which arrow is more likely to be detected by screening? That's another question I'm gonna ask you. Which arrow is more likely to be detected by screening, the fast arrow or the slow arrow? Well, you guys are getting pretty fast at this. This is good, good, good audience. All right. Oh, you're up to 40. Let's see what they say. This is an important question. Okay, and most of you get it right. It's the slow arrow. The question is, can you describe why that's true? Let me see if I can do that. This is a very important point about early detection. Why is that fast arrow so hard to catch? Because there's so little time. The so-called preclinical phase is so short, there's very little opportunity to find it early because it's growing fast. While the slow arrow, there's a long period of time where the preclinical phase, it exists there for a long time, and there's plenty of opportunity to find it early. And this leads to a very important feature of screening, which is that whenever we look for disease early, we disproportionately find slow-growing forms. has a fancy name. It's called length bias sampling, but I don't care if you know that. You just should know that one of the oddities of screening is whenever we look hard for disease, we're disproportionately finding slow-growing forms. Now, it'd be fine, the world would be simple if this were the only arrows out there, but some cancers are growing so slowly that they never become clinically relevant before the patient has died from something else. And this is one of the reasons it becomes really critical to think about how long should we be continuing screening if we're going to be doing screening. And then we have another possibility, things that meet the pathologic definition of cancer, but in fact don't progress, or even more surprisingly, might actually regress. And this brings me to say that we need to think about the word cancer differently. Not all things that pathologists label it cancer are necessarily going to pose problems for the patient. And this brings me to the barnyard pen of cancers. And there are three animals in the barnyard: the birds, the rabbits, and the turtles. And the goal of early detection is to fence them in, that is, to catch them early. But you can already see the problem. You cannot fence in a bird. The bird has already flown away. Screening doesn't help with the birds. The question is, can you treat them? These are the cancers that are the fastest growing. They're the most aggressive. They've already spread by the time they're detectable. The real question here is, can you treat them? Now, the rabbits are hopping around, and you can catch them if you're building enough fences. And these are the cancers that can be detected early by screening. And that may provide a benefit, although it may not, because in order to be beneficial, there's something else must be true, is it? That early treatments must somehow confer an advantage over late. And then there are the turtles. And you don't need any fences for the turtles, because these are the cancers that aren't going anywhere anyway. And the unfortunate reality is screening is really good at finding turtles, but doctors aren't good at distinguishing turtles from rabbits, so we tend to treat them all, thereby causing the major harm of early detection programs, overdiagnosis and overtreatment. I want to share an article with you from Life magazine called "The Plea Against the Blind Fear of Cancer." It's written by a cancer surgeon by the name of George Kreil at the Cleveland Clinic, and I want to just quote one paragraph to you. "In clinical practice, to say that a person has cancer gives us little information about the possible course of his disease as to say he has an infection. There are dangerous infections that may be fatal, and there are harmless infections that are self-limited and may disappear. The same is true of cancer. Cancer is not a single entity. It is a broad spectrum of diseases related to each other only in name." Now, I can't see you, so I can't see your ages and so forth, but I'm wondering how many of you know what Life magazine was. And those of you who know what Life magazine was can probably not remember the last time it didn't have color photographs. This article was written in 1955, the year I was born. It's a rude reminder. I've never had an original idea in my life. George Kreil was worried about this problem 65 years ago. And he is probably the originator of the birds, rabbit, turtle analogy. It's certainly not mine. How does that barnyard pen of cancer relate to this figure? Well, clearly the fast-growing arrows are the birds, the slow-growing are the rabbits, and all three of these are the turtles. And overdiagnosis is detecting the turtles. Let me stop there and see if there are any questions.
So we do have a lot of questions.
A lot of questions, okay,
good. All over the place, but I just wanted to start with a couple people wanted to know, when you had talked about mortality, is that following women for 5 years, 10 years, 20 years?
No, it's population-based mortality rates. It's the number of breast cancer deaths over the size of the population, and it's adjusted for age to the 2000 standard population. So what this is saying, the rate at which women in the United States, the United States mortality rate, the rate at which they die has been falling.
Okay. Thank you. There is another question that pertains to this section. It has to do with, wait a second, I'm sorry. They're coming in so fast that there's,
Oh, wow.
Somebody wants to know, how do we treat women without screening?
Oh, well, we treat women without screening all the time. About a third of breast cancers in this country are detected by women themselves. And that's, of course, how all breast cancers were detected prior to mammography. Mammography was a new thing. Women, just let it happen. You know, it's in my book, so I can say it, that's what happened with my wife. She noticed a breast lump 20 years ago. She's fine. Thank you.
Well, we're very happy about that. You know, and there are a couple questions about the interval cancer that is that was not detected.
Yeah, well, that I think that's one of the sad part of screening. You understand why everybody wants to screen because it just seems to make sense. But unfortunately, it tends to miss the cancers you most want to find, because they're simply not available to be found because they grow so fast.
Right, but there's no way to prove that it was there before, right?
No, it certainly wasn't evident before. If it was there, it's, you know, a very small collection of cells that no one could find.
Mm-hmm. Okay, why don't we go on, then maybe you will answer some of these questions as we go on.
I will. I hope so. We'll find out, won't we?
Even in your talk.
Yeah, I know. Okay, thanks, Michelle. Because it might be relevant at the end of this section, I'd like to start with the following question. Do you have a Y chromosome? Yes, no, I have not been tested for that. If anybody needs a hint, I'll just put a hint up there. Anybody want to change their answer? That's fine. Yeah. Let's see what we got here. Oh, we have some men in the audience. Great, excellent. Oh, and now they're getting more talkative. I don't know what that's about, but okay. It's fun to see how answers change, doesn't it? How can it go down? Oh, maybe the women are going up. And some of you, you don't need to be tested for this. This is not something I'm advocating. Here we go. So I want to share an article with you that I wrote in 2012 with Archie Blyer. It was called The Effect of Three Decades of Screening Mammography on Breast Cancer Incidence. The original title, and probably a more accurate title, is The Effect of Three Decades of Screening Mammography on the Stage-Specific Incidence of Breast Cancer in the United States. This violated the New England Journal's character count, so we had to change it. But it's really about how stage-specific incidence changes. And before I tell you about the article, I want you to commit to what you think screening should do. Ideally, screening should, one, increase the incidence of early and late stage disease, two, increase the incidence of early stage disease and have no effect on the incidence of late stage disease, or three, increase the incidence of early stage disease and decrease the incidence of late stage disease. Now, this is a hard question, so take your time, but it's an important question. right. And again, this is great. Most of you who answer have the right response. What ideally, screening should increase the incidence of early stage disease and decrease the incidence of late stage disease. Let me show you why. And this is the expected impact of an effective screening program. An incidence is the rate of new cases, the number of new cases per 100,000 population. Let's say early stage incidence starts here, late stage incidence starts here prior to screening. And this was about their respective positions in the early 1970s. You initiate screening, what do you expect to see? Well, you expect to see more early stage as you are looking harder, but at the same time, you expect to see a concomitant decline in late stage. Maybe it'll be delayed by a few years, but the two should react differently. One should go up and the other should go down. And maybe the easiest way to think about this is to say the goal of screening is to take a woman who was destined to be on this curve and put her on that curve. That's the goal of screening, such that you add the two curves together, the overall amount of breast cancer doesn't change much. In other words, screening shouldn't cause more cancer. It should just change the distribution of stages, that it takes people who were destined to be a late stage and turns them into an early stage. So what in fact happened to the stage-specific incidence of breast cancer in women age 40 and older in the United States? This is from 1975 to the time we published the article, 2008. And early stage went up dramatically, almost double in women age 40 plus, coinciding with the initiation of widespread mammography screening, which happened during the 1980s. And the question is, what happened to late stage disease? What happened to late stage incidence? Well, not much. Maybe it went down a little bit, but no big change. It was just basically stayed about the same. Now, this imbalance, that we don't see a concomitant decline in late stage disease, suggests two things. One, screening mammography largely fails the first prerequisite for a successful screening program. It should make it so fewer women present with late stage disease. And second, screening mammography is associated with a substantial amount of overdiagnosis. All these extra cases under this curve with a very small deficit. Now, that's the pattern of stage. Dramatic increase in early stage disease, not much change in late stage disease. About 4 years later, I looked at the problem in terms of breast cancer size. Coinciding with the initiation of widespread screening mammography, there was more than a doubling of small breast cancers, less than 2 centimeters in size. But again, the question is, what happens to large breast cancers? Well, the answer is not much. A little bit of a decline, but not much. There's still plenty of large breast cancers greater than 2 centimeters in size. So based on these two articles, I would say screening mammography has led to substantial increases in the detection of early stage and small cancers, but not substantial decrease in the presentation of late stage and large cancers. That's what we want to see reduced. So I hope you look at a headline like this somewhat differently now. Molecular breast imaging nearly quadruples detection for breast cancer. I think we've all been trained to see that as, oh, that's really good news. It finds more breast cancer. Until you realize, quadruples the detection, 4 times as much? Are we just finding a lot more turtles? we can't judge a test by how many cancers it finds. The goal isn't to find as many cancers as possible. The goal is to find those cancers that are ultimately going to matter. Oh, you'll like this. Smithsonian game changers. Could a bra actually detect breast cancer? Some of you may remember this. Now, where are we going with this? Can you imagine wearing a device that's monitoring you every day, looking for cancers? Is that the road to health? Or is that the road to anxiety, nervousness? And I mean, where are we going with this? And by the way, that doesn't look like a very comfortable bra. I mean, I've never worn one, nor would I tell you if I had. But I mean, seriously, is this really the direction we want to go? But guys, I know there's some guys out there. Maybe there's a business opportunity here. Maybe we could boxers actually detect prostate cancer? Maybe we should be selling underwear. From a dog, my dog seems to be able to find it. It's crazy. Any questions?
Sorry, I had to unmute. Wait a second. The questions just keep coming and coming and coming. There's some of them that I'm going to ask at the end because I think that it's important then, because a lot of people are asking very similar questions. So why don't we go on and then we can just do the general questions at the end.
All right, Michelle, I will take your suggestion. Just one more section here. Let me just ask you a serious question. What is your assessment of the audience polling during this presentation? Could you do without it? Would you say it's fun but doesn't really enhance your learning? Or would you say it helps keep me engaged and enhances my learning? Just trying to decide. I'm just beginning to work with this. And as I said, this is the first time I've ever done a national meeting from my living room and had no idea who I was talking to. Oh, well, that's good. That's good. Thank you. All right. We'll keep going. As I left you in the last section, you know, I think this title of a Washington Post op-ed I wrote with Steve Woloshin and Lisa Schwartz, Finding More Cancer Isn't the Answer, really captures one of the problems I think we have in cancer detection in this country, is that we just seem to value finding more as always. We assume that finding more is a good thing. This was written in 2007 when MRI was first began to be talked about as a way to find breast cancer. So let's talk a little bit about MRI screening because we know more about it now. And the DENSE trial, the DENSE tissue and early breast neoplasm screening, DENSE trial, was reported out in the New England Journal just a few months ago, late November. I want to be clear, my name is not on the list. I had nothing to do with it. It was done in the Netherlands. And I want to be clear at the outset, this was a well-designed, well-executed study. And I want to tell you a little bit about the study design. They enrolled women age 50 to 75 with extremely dense breasts. And their intake mammogram was negative. They were being regularly screened, and their mammogram at the start of the study was negative. Detected cancers are treated. In fact, that's true all through. Everything that's going to be found in this study, they get treated. And so we start with women who have a negative mammogram, no cancer found. And then they're randomized into one of two groups. The intervention group receives an MRI, the control group does not. They're followed forward in time till the subsequent mammogram, which is 2 years later. They're doing every other year screening in the Netherlands. And what they are counting in between is the interval cancers, which I talked to you about just as we started the presentation. And the primary finding of the trial was that adding MRI led to fewer interval cancers. Now, what was missing in that, excuse me, don't know why it decided it needs to know all that right now. What was missing was a comprehensive accounting of all cancers detected, which I'm going to provide for you in this table. And this is an important thing that's missing. They didn't really do a final tally of what had happened. And before I detail that table with you, I want to just remind you this is a randomized trial. That means that women are allocated into the intervention and the control group simply by the role of chance, analogous to flipping a coin. Heads go here, left, you know. This is the way we do, this is the gold standard design that we use to evaluate treatment, and it's also the same design we should be using to evaluate screening. So that's really good. Now, the reason we do that is to produce two comparable groups of women, such that we believe ultimately the total number of important cancers ought to be the same in both groups. Ultimately, the two groups should face the same risk of cancer. So let's come back to the table of a comprehensive accounting in the DENSE trial. And these data come from the article itself. It comes from figure one, cobbled together from table three and a table in the appendix. And then I did what I thought was a really clever methodologic approach. It's called addition. So this is very high level stuff. So here's the comprehensive accounting of cancer diagnoses per 1,000 screens in the MRI versus the no MRI group. At the intake mammogram, there were zero in both groups. Remember, that was an eligibility criteria for the trial. There are 9.8 MRI detected cancers per 1,000 in the MRI group. There are none in the control group. Why? Because they didn't have an MRI, so no cancers were found. There are 2.5 interval cancers in the MRI group. There are 5 in the control group. So what's the effect of MRI? Well, 2.5 fewer interval cancers per 1,000. That was the main finding of the trial. That was their major result. Subsequent mammogram, 2 years later, there were 4.1 in the MRI group and 6.0 in the control group. So the effect of MRI is 1.9 fewer cancers on subsequent mammogram. Whether that's important or not, that's a different question. But here's my really novel method. It's called addition, right? I'm going to add up all the cancers in the MRI group. Well, there's 16.4. All the cancers in the control group, they're 11. So what's the effect of MRI? Well, there's 5.4 more cancers overall. This is after a mammogram 2 years later. Well, that's weird. Remember, ultimately, we expect the two groups to have the same total. Now, here's another way to look at it. Here are the rate of MRI cancer detection in the MRI group. Here are the interval cancers, and here are the cancers found by mammography 2 years later. And my question is about this difference. Where are the 5.4 cancers in the control group? We expect them to ultimately be there. Where are they? Are they going to appear later? Or did they go away? Wow. Well, the conventional explanation is these 5.4 extra cancers found by MRI are growing very slowly. So slowly, they're not even evident on a mammogram 2 years later. If that's true, over half of MRI detected cancers, okay, I did a division here, 5.4 over 9.8. Over half of MRI detected cancers are growing so slowly that they're undetectable by a mammogram 2 years later. what are we doing? Why are we looking for cancers that aren't even going to appear on a mammogram 2 years later? Now, the alternative explanation is those 5.4 extra cancers found by MRI spontaneously regress in the control group. That's pretty wild. Could that really be? Well, here's a study of small, less than 4 centimeter kidney cancers that are just being observed. Nothing's being done to these patients. They're trying to decide what's happening to them. Well, a lot of them are growing, but about a quarter of them are regressing. And the same thing in surveillance of small papillary thyroid cancers, less than 1.5 centimeters. About a third of them are getting smaller. So we know cancers can regress. Why not breast cancer? So here's your last question. What do you think happened to those 5.4 extra cancers? One, I think they're still there, but they're growing so slowly they aren't apparent on a mammogram 2 years later. Or two, I think they went away. By the way, don't think too hard about this. There's no right answer. No one knows. I'll be real interested what people do here. So most of you think they're slow growing. Okay. So I want to come back to the article that I mentioned I would come back to, The Natural History of Invasive Breast Cancers Detected by Screening Mammography, with Per Hendrik Zahl and Jean Malin in 2008. And this is a study I encourage you to look at if you're interested in the idea of regression, but I'll give you a sense of the design. It was a so-called staggered cohort design, and the control group was not screened until the last year. And so its pattern of cumulative incidence is, in the first 2 years, there are about 450 cancers per 100,000 diagnosed. In the second year, you had about doubled. But in the third period, I'm sorry, these are 2 years, it goes up as they become screened. Now, the screened group received mammography every 2 years. And so there's a screening exam at this point, and of course more cancers are found in that group, and here they're screened again, but here they're screened again. So they get 3 screening tests. But my question is, why weren't these extra cancers found there, found at the final mammogram up here? Why didn't this dot should be up here? I mean, because if everything, all this excess down here was bound to be ultimately progressing in the control group, you'd expect the control group to go up here, but they're not. And so we wrote this, because the cumulative incidence among controls never reached that of the screened group, it appears that some breast cancers detected by repeated mammographic screening would not persist to be detectable by a single mammogram at the end of 6 years. This raises the possibility that the natural course of some screen-detected invasive breast cancer is to spontaneously regress. Crazy. Remember, you're listening to a radio DJ from Thermopolis, Wyoming. Okay, where do I sit on breast cancer screening using MRI? There are benefits and harms. The benefit from this trial is there are fewer interval cancers. The harms is there are more cancers overall. There's no easy way to compare those benefits and harms. They're sort of apples and oranges, and you have to make your own decision. But fewer interval cancers, does that mean that women live longer or live better? Well, that's not known. We have no idea this has any effect on the rate at which people die from breast cancer. And those more cancers overall mean there are also more biopsies. A recent report in the Journal of the American Medical Association suggested that MRI leads to 3 times as many biopsies. And that means more cancer treatment, more cancers overall, means more women are being treated for breast cancer. It's no picnic. Now, I want to come back to where I started. I want to make sure we all applaud the good news in breast cancer. Breast cancer mortality, the death rate nationwide is down, call it 40%. That is unambiguous good news. And this largely reflects improved treatment, not screening. The bad news is we're stuck in a technological arms race, a constant desire to find more cancer. We move from plain film mammography to digital mammography, to add breast ultrasound, to add 3D mammography, and now breast MRI. This is not the path to health. Thank you very much for your attention. I'll be happy to take any questions.
So I just want to say, Dr. Welsh, we thank you very much for your presentation. And we have so many questions that it's absolutely impossible to even start to ask you all of them. But I'll just do some that are quick. Some of them are about treatment. Some of them are about, you know, different kinds of breast cancer. And I don't think we have time to go into that. But one of the questions is, could a slow-growing cancer eventually change to a fast-growing cancer?
I think that's a great question. And I think the short answer is we don't know, because we don't observe things over time. One of the real hard parts of learning about the progression rates and the behaviors of cancers is we never follow them. We always intervene. Anytime anything's labeled cancer, physicians intervene. So that's a good question. The answer is we don't know. I think a little bit more answers. We don't think that happens often. We think in general the cancers are relatively stable. The worst cancers are the ones that have multiple clones, and you know, you control one and something else happens in another. But in general, we think that most slow-growing cancers stay slow-growing.
Okay. One other quick question is MRI better for invasive lobular, since it's very difficult to see on a mammogram?
I'm going to give the response I learned as a third-year medical student, that it's like a really important skill. I don't know. I don't know anything about how it functions in lobular cancer.
Okay, so it is 11 o'clock. I just want to read one statement that one of our advocates wrote that I think that is important, that could end your talk here. It said, in 2015, Sharon Bagley wrote in the Boston Globe, it turns out that some cancers detected by mammograms would never have posed a threat to a woman's health or life. Others are so slow growing that even if they're not detected until they cause symptoms, they're treatable. Still others are so aggressive that even catching them early is too late. Do you agree with that statement?
Yes.
Right.
Unambiguously, yes.
So I feel really badly because the questions keep coming in, because this is an important topic and a lot of the things we don't know, as you have said, but you did show us a very, very important view. I really have to conclude this workshop for this afternoon. I want to thank you very much, Dr. Welsh, for this thoughtful, provoking discussion. And I want to thank everybody that's on the call. And I know that, as I said before, there are a lot of questions. Now, there is not a advocate session afterwards. But tomorrow there will be an advocate networking session after the afternoon at 2 o'clock, where we will be continuing the discussion from this plenary session. And we hope you will drop by. And I'm really sorry to everyone that we couldn't answer your questions, but we just ran out of time. So come tomorrow to the session that we will have, and you can have a discussion on it. And I thank everybody very much for attending.
Thank you.
Thank you.